Well, thank God. I think the lecture will go on. Thank you for your patience again. Ladies and gentlemen, I don't want to take your time. I was going to read this prepared statement that I sent out to the parish when we announced this lecture. But we have two distinguished folks who have dedicated a lot of their time to a very important subject, especially for us Russians and for world history, for that matter. You know that back in the 70s, a group of enthusiasts, geologists and history buffs, and a gentleman who made in the Soviet Times documentaries, Gilly Ryabov, found the remains of the last royal family near Ekaterinburg. My matushka and I had the honor of meeting these people back in the 80s when this was not being publicized. We went to Gilly Ryabov's apartment. We had long conversations with him, and we kept up our friendship, and I was found worthy to be able to serve a Vesper service at the place where the relics were really found, ultimately. In any case, it was shown by various DNA experts in the world that these are indeed the remains of the royal family, missing two. And they were found years later, and also identified as belonging to the children of the last Russian Tsar. And among the people who studied these relics was Dr. Mikhail Coble of the Air Force's DNA identification lab in Rockville, Maryland. And he was gracious enough to come and speak to our parish a few years ago, and as I mentioned just recently, unfortunately he hasn't learned Russian since then, but we will forgive him because he's done a lot of good for Russian history, and by participating and identifying the DNA of the royal family. And also we have with us Captain Peter Sarandinaki, whom we've known a long time. I married them, he and his wife, 25 years ago in Nyack, New York. We're actually relatives. And Peter has been very active in the Romanov remains issue. And also he's begun searching for the remains of Mikhail Alexandrovich Romanov in Perm. And he will speak about that as well, which is a very, very interesting. And hopefully they're getting closer and closer to finding the remains of the other Romanovi. So please, I'm going to pass the microphone on to Dr. Coble and Peter Sarandinaki. I think Peter will go first. Yes. And say a few words about his organization's search. And then we will go back and forth between the two. Thank you.
Good afternoon, and thank you for your patience in waiting for this. We're very happy to be here with you and to tell you about our work for the past 25 years. What we'll do is first, my purpose is to talk about the history of the search for the Romanov remains, their identification, and then I will talk about the search for the remains of Mikhail Romanov. My story, I first learned, I'm a retired American sea captain and merchant marine. And how does an American sea captain get involved in all this? Well, I heard all these stories about the Romanovs from my grandmother when I was 10 years old. She started telling me how my great-grandfather, who was head of the Vendensky Regiment in Penza, Russia, was a very good friend of then-investigator Nicholas Sokolov. And together they would go hunting and before the First World War, and they were very good friends. When the war started, the regiment was transferred to the front, and then later on, my great-grandfather went up in rank and became a lieutenant general in the Tsarist army. He was saved by his troops, actually, and not killed. At first, became part of the Red Army, but he started working with General Kutepov, who started an underground railway to save as many officers as they could and send them off to the newly formed White Army. So what he would do is he would send my grandmother, who was then 18 years old, dressed like a cleaning girl, into the Lubyanka prison. And she would go and get the laundry from the officers who were about to be killed, but still they did the laundry. And in that laundry were pieces of paper with the names and addresses of officers that needed to be saved. And how, as she wrote it, and as she told me, that she went countless times into the prison getting the laundry and the names, and she saved a lot of officers who went on to fight against the Reds. Later on, so my great-grandfather escaped, went over to Siberia, and then was working with a general staff. Left his wife and two daughters in Pienza, and then they followed escape by using what they call the nuns route, going from monastery to monastery and so forth. And my great-grandfather gave my grandmother an Nagant pistol, and he said, use 6 bullets and the last ones for yourself. And that's how it was. My great-grandmother's mother, Baroness von Rosen, committed suicide so that they could escape. So that's how tough it was for these families to escape out of Russia. So finally they went out into the steppes, and Cossacks were coming at them, and it turns out they were white, and they ended up. So in 7 days after the murder of the royal family, my great-grandfather was with those troops that arrived into Ekaterinburg. Next slide, please. They found that the royal family, the servants, next slide, had been taken first from St. Petersburg to Tobolsk to Ekaterinburg. So go to the next slide. And so when the white troops arrived into Ekaterinburg, they found a double fence around the Ipatiev house. My great-grandfather ordered the troops to tear down the fence. His adjutant, who later became my grandfather, Kirill Mikhailovich Narishkin, went down into the basement, and he saw what happened. My great-grandfather did not have the nerve, I guess, to go see. So an investigation of the murder was started. Next. And these are the killers. Peter Yermakov, Yurovsky, the leader, Yermakov the second. Next slide. They had taken them into the basement. This is what my grandfather saw, the basement. A photograph from the Harvard collection. Next slide. And see that? Yeah.
It's thinking.
Anyway, so the investigation of the murder was started, and there were two investigators, Namyotkin and Sergeyev, who were hired by the White Army, except that they really they did a lot of good work, and they found out where all what happened to them and so forth, where they were taken, except the White Army wasn't satisfied and fired them. And when my great-grandfather then introduced Sokolov to the general staff as the man to do the investigation of the murder, and that's how Sokolov got his job. Sokolov went to, first of all, what had happened at number three, the place where the murder occurred, was down here in Katrinburg. The bodies were taken up to Gandhinayama, number one, and number two is a little road that goes off. And the bodies were dumped into the open pit. If you go to the next slide. This is Nicholas Sokolov, 1919. Next. All right. So Sokolov then took charge of the investigation. And where he's standing now, he's standing all over the spot where there was one of the bonfires. And according to General Dietrichs, there were two bonfires, one in the next slide. Okay. Sokolov lost half a month pumping this water out of here, so maybe the bodies were underneath. Keep going. All right. So here is the open pit that, if you ever go to Ekaterinburg, you'll see this open mine shaft that is wider now, but this little crossing is still there. I went across it countless times. So the bodies were thrown into this pit. It was about 30 foot deep. And the White Army later on found underwater, they found a floor. And under the floor, they found the girl's dog who was killed. So they went to a lot to hide all the information, to hide everything as they could. But Sokolov used to come over our family home in France after they got out of Russia, and was telling them how when he first arrived to the open pit area, if you go to the next slide, right here, there was a fresh bed of clay. And so first Sokolov, this pile of gravel and so forth that you see was taken from the bottom of the mine shaft to see if there was anything. And it was left like that, actually for us, because Sokolov never had the time to go through it. Next slide. The bodies were taken. They were about 50 people there trying to destroy these bodies. They tried to burn four of the bodies. Now, what we found out later, that, you know, they tried to burn Alexis, Maria, the Tsar, and someone else. And Michael determined that because of the DNA also with the bones, or the heel bones, they were very light, and thus they're supposed to be heavy and dense. Bodies were taken, that were burnt, and then they were thrown back. Well, they tried to burn the phone. They were thrown into the mine shaft. 50 people were in this mine shaft, in this area, working on this, and everybody knew about it. They were going back and forth into the town. Pretty soon the whole town knew where the bodies were. And so the Galashok and the head of the whole investigation came to this place and told them, get rid of the bodies, let's take them to the mine on the way to Moscow. So they packed them up again on carts and carriage, and finally on the truck like this, and took them down this road, the Kaptiki Road. And it's still this, looks like this, because it's in July, it's very rainy, and I can understand why the truck finally got stuck. Next slide. Got stuck underneath where this wooden bridge is. This is a photograph taken by Sokolov. Sokolov hired hundreds of people to comb the forest, to go across it, and to, maybe they were going 5 yards apart looking for a grave. Many times he went through this area, and never once did he think perhaps that's where the grave is. And that's exactly where the 9 sets of remains were found, underneath this little bridge. Next slide. This is a photograph that we found in the archives. This is Peter Yermakov, the killer. And in the back of the photograph, written in pencil, it said, I'm standing on, in Russian, I'm standing on the grave of the Tsars. And right away, of course, this was it. We knew. And perhaps we thought, you know, when Avdonin, you know, eventually opened up the grave, they found the skulls and took them for examination. Next slide. But they weren't able to determine anything. So, and also they had to keep the secret because Russia was still communist. And another photograph, an interesting photograph Sokolov took, right here is the Kartiki Road. But here's this spot right here is where they actually found the remains of Alexis and Maria. This is the southern part of the Pig's Meadow. When we search this area, our third search, and I went back to this area here because we searched the whole northern area. I went back to the spot and I started taking photographs. We had Tajiki workers and so forth. And I was actually standing on the grave of the children. I didn't even know it. So this is how difficult this work is. Next slide. Sokolov never found the remains. He concluded wrongly, and I repeat wrongly, that all the remains were burnt because he really had no proof to determine that. What we do know is that from the archives and from what the killers wrote, when the killers took the bodies to the pigs, to the Four Brothers Mine area, there was an expert that was supposed to come to burn the bodies, except that that guy never made it because he fell off his horse and broke his leg. So then Peter Yermakov was given the task of trying to burn the bodies as this whole. And after being taken out of the water, the bodies were totally frozen from the cold water. They weren't even burning, so they just gave up on that. Sokolov finally made it. My great-grandfather was transferred to Vladivostok, where he became the military governor of the whole of Mur region. And Sokolov came there. In 1920, in January, there was a coup against my great-grandfather, and the Japanese saved my family. Sokolov left Russia with a proof of the murder, whatever he had. And he went with General Jeannin, the French general, into Harbin, and eventually met my, the Japanese saved my family, and met my grandparents and my great-grandparents in Japan. My grandparents, Narishkins, and the Sokolovs traveled together on a ship called André Le Bon. And this box, the proof of a murder, there were many boxes, but especially this one, it was about this size. And it was taken by Sokolov and held by Sokolov. And it was kept, when they traveled around the world, it was kept under my grandmother's bunk. So one day while guarding the box, they always guarded the box, even on the ship. And I come to hear from Sokolov's grandson, I took that photograph, Sokolov's grandson has that box, that Mao Zedong was traveling on the same, going to France as well. So very, very interesting. So next slide, please. In the box, we had Dr. Botkin's dentures. In the box, we had melted fat bullets, the pieces of wood where the bayonet stabs went with blood and so forth. A lot of those items now, if you ever care to go, are up in the museum in Jordanville at our monastery. There's a very nice museum that you can go visit, and those are what the items of the box. There was also the Empress's finger. Next slide, please. And we don't know where that is yet. Maybe someone had kept it or something like that. In 1978, Alexander Avdonin, his wife Galina Gilyaryabov, his wife and another friend, decided to search for the remains of Nicholas II and the royal family. They were all enthusiasts, and they were really protected by the Ministry of the Interior over there, the MVD. Next. And so they opened up the grave. They found the bridge. They climbed up. The bridge, of course, was covered with dirt. But they climbed up on a tree, and they were able to see the silhouette of the bridge. And they opened it up, and they found three skulls. Two skulls were taken to Moscow for them to check out, and then were brought back and they were put back in the grave, and they decided to keep the secret until Russia changed. And in 1991. Dr. Galeryabov told the world what they found next. And you can see the previous picture, the skeleton number 4 was of the Tsar. In that grave that they opened up, there were 9 sets of remains, and they found that 2 were missing. One of the daughters and also Tsarevich Alexei. Everybody else was found. I can tell you right now that, and Father Victor knows that in 1995, when they did DNA, I was given the shavings from the DNA samples that when they cut the bones, and they sent them to brought to my house, gave Father Victor half, and I kept the other half, and I put them by our wedding icons. It was around midnight. I went back into the kitchen, and my wife Masha was also the witness. And then an hour later, I went back into the bedroom, and the whole bedroom smelled like roses. And when I went to that piece of, there's a piece of paper with shavings or like dust of from the bones, but from the little shavings from Nicholas II and from Dr. Botkin, the aroma of roses was so strong that it smelled up the whole room. And that was just incredible. And I gave it to a priest, so I felt that I didn't feel that I was worthy to keep something like that. So, next. And this is how the remains, by the way, that was how the remains lay for 7 years, that morgue. Now, my friend, Dr. Sergei Nikitin, started doing the facial reconstruction over the skulls. Dr. Botkin Demidova, next slide, please. Olga Nikolai. Keep going. Tatiana, Anastasia, and next slide, Troop Alexandra. Next. All right. So we had I asked Dr. Nikitin how he determined that they had Anastasia, because the American scientist says that you might have the wrong daughter. Anastasia is missing, and you have Maria. Well, it's because he did also photo superimposition. This is Nikitin's reconstruction of Anastasia. This is her photograph. This is Anastasia's reconstruction. This is a photograph of Maria over here. And so as you can see, with there's certain points that he measured, and the points match exactly, and the shape of the head matches exactly. And also, when we compare it to Maria, the points do not match up. Only one matches, but the shape of the head does not match up. There were other things involved too that things that were told, but basically, the Russians were convinced that they had Anastasia. Maria was missing. And that became a bone of contention at one point when I took American scientists to Russia in February 1998, before the burial of the royal family. Took Dr. Anthony Fulcetti from the University of Florida, Gainesville, and Dr. Diane France from Colorado State University, both director of human ID labs, both forensic anthropologists. And they determined they also agreed with Dr. William Maples of Florida also that the Russians had the wrong daughter. But so then I went back to the Russians, and I asked them who determined, I didn't know that Nikitin had done this, who determined that you had Anastasia? And they all pointed at Nikitin. I said, well, the Americans will present their paper in front of the Academy of Forensic Science, in the year 2000 saying that you're wrong. So Nikitin came to America, presented his paper in front of the Academy of American Academy of Forensic Science, proving his case that Maria was missing. And my whole thing was that we'll determine really that when we found, if and when we find the next set of remains. So next, please. So this is Nikitin's work. He did a reconstruction of, actually this is Diane France. She sent a scan of her own skull, and to see how close it is, how close his work is amazing. So I have no doubt with Nikitin's work, really. And next, please. Then there was the burial in 1998. Next slide. So we decided to start searching for the other two children. Next. So when we came, this is what we found. They had cleared the forest area, as you can see, on the right side behind the church, put up a cross there, and it said that all the remains were burnt. I said they're wrong. You know, we'll find the other. But and behind already the open pit, Sokolov already had opened it up more. Next slide, please. So remember from the mine shaft, right? Next. And this is us already working on that pile. Next. That's Dr. Avdonin, September 98. Next. That's myself, Avdonin. And next. And I found the first bullet from Nagant pistol. I got a shot of vodka for that. that was in that pile of stones. Next. Because what they did is they took off all their clothing and everything, and they all wore the diamonds and all this. So we found a lot of on the third day I found a white topaz stone. Sokolov found 14. I found the 15th one. We didn't find that many items, but we did finding what Sokolov found. Next. I found a button. I found, you see the snap on top. The back was still in there, meaning the clothes were ripped off. They're ripped. They weren't gentle. Next. And they found bones, but Sokolov found bones as well. They were animal bones. Next. Okay, next. So, in 1998, we're still searching. We also found, interesting, red wax in the mine shaft. Alexei carried red wax in his pocket, and that was proof to us, and nails he carried too, but he carried red wax. He played with it, and that was proof to us that he was there. Next. We did seismic profiling of the whole area. And the next. Electromagnetic studies as well, finding anomalies. We checked every single one of them out, and nothing panned out. Next. It started to snow. So then we had to, next. We moved the whole pile of stones, and the pile of stones also had charcoal and all that in there. But next. Such a beautiful place. So many horrible things happened. Next. And the second search was in June 1999. Next. So everything, the flowers came back, everything came back. And what we're looking for is also the bonfires. Because what the killers wrote, Yurovsky, was that after the two children, after they burned the bodies of those two children, they buried them next to a bonfire. And then they covered that up, and they built a bonfire on top of that. And so we were looking for signs of the bonfire. That's one of the reasons we started working at the Four Brothers Mine area, because there were on the General Dietrich's map of the whole area, two X's signified bonfires, and that's what that's what we found. And we actually, I did it by compass and steps, like they said, you know, and we found those two bonfires. Next. So we're looking, next. So we started searching for these bonfires, next. And we found traces of charcoal everywhere that was spread out. Next. And here was one of the fires. This is where Sokolov, you saw in the first picture, Sokolov standing. This is the exact spot where he was standing. There was a bonfire underneath. We found nothing in the, because he already had gone through it. Also, right now there's a sidewalk over it. So, you know, they didn't know that. They just put a sidewalk right over it. So this was destroyed instead of being kept. Go ahead. One thing is, remember I told you about the fresh bed of clay. We dug down about 20 centimeters. We found a site of a huge bonfire about the size of this table. The clay was already brick. And we found this melted neck of a bottle. The fire was so hot, and that's where they burned the bodies. And then we saw that they had swept all the coal into the mine shaft. There was coal never disappears. And so this is what we found. The earth doesn't lie. Keep going. And this is what the Four Brothers mine area looks now. Actually, it's fancier, but this is the mine shaft and people go. It's a holy ground, it's a holy place. Okay, next. The third search was in July 2004. Keep going. And we went to the Pig's Meadow. This is the actual grave where the bridge was, that you saw that photograph. And people come and pray. It's a very quiet place, but the church, the church, they used to go in their religious processions, through this area here. But because they don't believe that these are the remains, they built a separate road going to the Four Brothers mine area. So, all right, next. So we're comparing, this is the whole northern area. So the truck came down this way and that's where we got stuck. Okay, next. So we hired Tajikistani workers to search out the whole area. Plus we had, next. We had a radar, that's all we had at the time. So we're searching the area for radar, looking for signs of any digging or something like that. Keep going. We hired equipment to level out the ground so the radar could work better, but nothing, keep going. And whenever we found something, like a signal like this, that means somebody had dug here, we would have to open it up again. Next. So we searched and nothing was found here. Next. And the final search was in July 2007, that wasn't done by me. It was done by a local group of Russian Army who go to battlefields to try to find remains. And so this is the northern area over here that we searched out, and this was left over here to do. This is what I wanted to do in 2007, but I didn't get a chance. They did, in this spot right here, go ahead, they found the grave of Alexei and Maria. Next. And that's all that was found from two bodies. That is all. And you notice this curve over here, that's from bullet hole. And but scientists determined that in these they have a very young male and a very young female. Keep going. Okay. Keep going. Okay, keep going. So nine bodies were found, and 70 meters away from the other set. Keep going. And so what I did then is when Nikitin called me, I called up Dr. Falsetti, University of Florida, who wanted to go and study these remains as an anthropologist. And in speaking to him, I said, by the way, do you know the head of the U.S. Army DNA lab? He says, yeah, I do. His name is Finelli. He says, I said, Boy, I would love to get up to do the DNA study of these things. Maybe we could organize it, you know, I could organize it. And I spoke to the Russians, Vladimir Solovyov and Dr. Nikolai Devolin from Ekaterinburg, and they all agreed, let's do it, let's do the DNA. So that's when I wrote, actually Falsetti spoke to Finelli and two Italian boys, you know, but very fine people, believe me, fine people. And Colonel Finelli decided to come on board with the U.S. Army DNA lab, and hence Dr. Michael Coble, please. After Dr. Coble finishes, I will continue, and I'll talk to you about if. Let me know when you want to take a break, Father. If you want to take a break, but after I'll talk about our search for. Mikhail Alexandrovich Romanov. Dr. Coble.
Okay. Okay, thank you very much. Thank you, Peter. And again, I personally would like to apologize for the late start. The technology can be a bit of a problem. And it reminds me that Father Victor did admonish me for not learning more Russian, but I'll tell you this story that a friend of mine, a very good friend of mine from California, he said he was in South Korea and he was giving a presentation, and the day before his talk, he noticed that a lot of the speakers who were giving their talks in Korean, they would constantly say, you know, some word like goshom, goshom, goshom. So he thought, maybe they're saying thank you. And so that evening, everyone he met, he would say, Goshom, Goshom, Goshom. And so finally someone said, why are you telling everyone next slide? So I'm afraid what Russian I may speak may not mean much. So, okay, I think I'll go ahead and get started so that we can, again, apologize for the late start. So I'm going to talk about the DNA identification work that we did at the Armed Forces DNA Identification Laboratory. This laboratory used to be in Rockville, Maryland. It's now been relocated to Dover, Delaware. So if we could go ahead with the next slide. So I no longer work for the Armed Forces DNA Identification Lab for AFDIL. When the lab decided to move to Dover, I made a career decision to stay in the area. So I now work at NIST, National Institutes of Standards and Technology in Gaithersburg. So the work I'm going to talk about is the work that I did when I was at AFDIL. But again, I'm not speaking on behalf of the laboratory, and anything that I say, opinions are strictly mine and not the opinion of the Department of Defense. So when you do these types of historical investigations, it's often important that you have replication of work. And so we had, in this particular study, we had our group at AFDIL. So it's taking, there we go. We had our scientists at AFDIL that were working on this problem, and then I asked the Russian authorities if I could also invite a good collaborator from a laboratory in Austria, in Innsbruck. So they were in parallel doing the same work. We had two Russian scientists that were staying with us in Rockville, and there were two Russian scientists who were in Austria who were doing the work alongside our colleagues there. And then what we did is we did not talk to one another. So we did our testing, Austria did their testing, and then we sent our work to a third party. And that was Dr. Peter Gill. Dr. Peter Gill is in the UK, and he was involved with the early testing in the 1990s. He was the British lab that did the original work. And so he looked at our results, he looked at the Austrian results, and he wrote a report that said they both came to the same conclusion independently of one another. Okay, so I thought it would probably be best to give a very brief background on how to do forensic DNA testing, and it'll be like an episode of CSI. We'll do it in 5 minutes. It really takes a lot longer to do these types of testing, but I'll give you just the brief overview of how we do forensic DNA testing. So if you take a look at a cell, at a human cell, you actually have two human genomes. So you have the big blue circle there, the big blue ball, is the nucleus of the cell. And in that nucleus, you have the DNA that makes the code for proteins and codes for all the various functions that you do and so forth. And this is where you get a lot of very high power of discrimination. When you're talking about forensic testing, and you may hear in a court case that there's a quintillion times, probability that this person does. So that's the type of testing that you're doing, the nuclear DNA testing. Very powerful. The other genome that you have is the mitochondria, which are these little circular structures that one of the main functions of the mitochondria is to provide energy for the cell. And interestingly, they have their own DNA. It's DNA that's separate from the nucleus. So you actually have two types of DNA in your cell. You have the nuclear DNA that you inherit from your mother and father. You get half of your DNA from your mom and half from your dad. 3 billion bases of information. And then you have the mitochondria, which are actually, mitochondrial genome is quite small, 16,000 base pairs. But the advantage that mitochondria DNA gives to the forensic scientist is that when you have a very degraded sample, when you have a bone sample that's been in the ground for 50, 60, hundreds, they're getting DNA from Neanderthals, so from thousands and hundreds of thousands of years, then the mitochondrial DNA, because you have so many mitochondria, your cells need a lot of energy, then it can provide you with some information. So let's talk about the nuclear STR testing that we did. All right, so if you take a look in the nuclear genome, you will find certain regions where you have repetitive DNA. And so in this case, we're looking at a certain region of the chromosome. Again, you have two chromosomes, one from your mother and one from your father. And in this certain region, there's this repeat. So you have the nucleotide bases, the four bases, A, G, C, T, that make up DNA. And you have in this one particular region this repeat, G, A, T, A, four bases that repeat side by side by side. So gata, 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 gata. So on the bottom, the maternal chromosome, you have six of these repeats. And the chromosome you get from your father, you may have eight of these repeats. So the number of repeats can be very variable in the population. And so what we do is we make use of this variation in forensics, and we have to first amplify this up. So there's this process called PCR, the polymerase chain reaction. It's kind of like a Xerox machine where you take one copy of a document, you put it on there, and you make many thousands of documents from this. So we notice that we're on this, the way this machinery works is that we have these little short fragments of DNA that have this red dot attached to it. These are called primers, and that red dot is a fluorescent dye. And so we amplify, we make copies. And so when you go through this process of PCR, if you hit the next and hit it again, you make millions and millions and millions of copies of these fragments. Some of them have six repeats. Some of them have eight repeats. And they all have this little red fluorescent dye attached to it. So we've been able to label these fragments with this red dye. So in the next step, we pass these little labeled fragments through this machine called a capillary electrophoresis. So inside of the instrument, you have a capillary. Go ahead. And it's kind of hard to see, but this capillary is about the size of a hair. And so it's very thin. And inside of this capillary is a polymer. It's kind of like a pancake syrup. So it's very viscous. So because DNA has a negative charge, we put a positive charge on one end of the capillary, and the DNA starts swimming to that positive end. So as the DNA is passing through the capillary, the little size, the six size fragments, the fragments with the six repeats, they're able to move a little bit quicker than the eight repeat fragments. So we're getting separation of the six and the eight. And they eventually get to this little spot in the capillary where a laser shines through. And when that laser hits that red dye, it gives off a red signal. And that signal gets captured and gets transformed into a red peak that you're seeing here. So this is the six repeat, and this would be the eight repeat. So we're able to actually visualize how many repeats were amplified from this particular individual. Now, the FBI decided back in 1997 that the U.S. would study, we would all look at the same 13 markers. So these are called the CODIS loci, and this is what makes up our national DNA database. So we look at 13 pieces of information, and when you look at 13 different pieces of information, you can get the type of power that can give you an individualization. So we could tell my profile would be different from anyone else's profile in this room if we look at those 13 pieces of information. In fact, the only way that you would predict that it would match is if I had an identical twin. In that case, you do share the exact same DNA. Okay. So this is an example of a kit that's used in forensics. It's actually looking at 16 pieces of information. So the first marker I want to point out is this marker. It's amelogenin. It's used as a sex type marker, so we can tell whether the person is a male or female. And in this particular sample, we only see one X. That's because this is a female. Females have two X chromosomes, XX. Males are XY. So the reason you only see one peak, why don't you see two peaks, is because both of those X's are sitting on top of one another. So there's actually two peaks there, but they're the same size, so they're both sitting on top of one another. If this were a male sample, you would see an X peak and a Y peak, so you would see two separate peaks. And then we have 15 pieces of information, the 13 CODIS loci that we all test in the U.S., and then there are two markers that are unique to this kit, so there are 15 total markers. Okay. Now, what's the probability that I would find someone else in the world who has this particular type? 1 in 129 quadrillion. So that's that's saying it's the same probability of taking 129 quadrillion white marbles and putting in one red marble and then sticking your hand in there and picking out the one red. That's about the same probability for this particular profile. Now, this is actually my daughter's profile. My daughter Sophia, who my wife and I adopted Sophia from Russia, and her little brother Matthew. So whenever Sophia asks me, "Dad, am I special?" I'm like, "Yeah, 129 quadrillion. I'd say that's pretty special." But she doesn't quite get that. She doesn't get my jokes most of the time. Actually, she does most of the time. So now we have the nuclear DNA, but there's also, again, a couple of things I want to point out. Go ahead. Those are the autosomes, those are the nuclear DNA that we're using for STRs that we do in this type of testing. We also have the sex chromosomes. We have XX again, if you're a female, two X's, males XY. And then there's also outside of the nucleus, in the cytoplasm of the cell, we have mitochondria, which have their own genome, the mitochondrial DNA. And there's a little bit of a relationship between mitochondrial DNA and the Y chromosome because of the way they are inherited. So if we take a look at your DNA, and we take a look at your great-grandparents, as Peter mentioned, his great-grandfather. You are about 1/8 of your all of your great-grandparents. So you have 8 great-grandparents, and you are about 1/8 of all of your great-grandparents. And we can keep going back, you know, 1/16th, your great-great-grandparents, and so forth. We can keep going back in time, and you can figure out what percentage of your family you inherited from all of your relatives, immediate relatives in your family tree. But when it comes to the Y chromosome, men only get the Y chromosome from their father, who got it from their father, who got it from their father, and from their father. So even though you have 4 great-grandfathers, only one of those great-grandfathers passed his Y down to you. So that's a really unique feature about Y chromosome testing, is that you can find relatives that share the same Y type when you're trying to do a human identification. Okay? So this is their STRs, or these short tandem repeats, are also on the Y chromosome. And for the most part, you only see one peak at each marker here. So there's one peak, and there's one peak, and there's one peak. And that's because you men only have one Y chromosome, so you don't have two. So you don't see two peaks like you do with the nuclear DNA, where you have your mother and your father have given you DNA. Now, YSTR testing has been used a lot in forensics and in a lot of historical cases, like the case of Esten Hemmings, who Esten Hemmings' mother was Sally Hemmings, who was a slave of Thomas Jefferson. And so one of the descendants of Esten Hemmings said, you know, I've been told that my father was, my great-great-great-grandfather was Thomas Jefferson, and I'd like to go to this party that they have, the Jefferson family has every year in Charlottesville. I'd like to come. And they said, no, we don't think that's right. I don't think you actually are. And so they said, well, let's do this Y testing. And when they did, so if you take a look at, so I have to say, you know, Jefferson had, I think he had 1 daughter or 2 daughters. He didn't have any sons that we know of. And so if you look at other relatives, they had the same Y chromosome as Esten Hemmings. And it's a really rare Y chromosome. So it's not like there were a lot of these. So now we can't say with definitive proof that Jefferson, Thomas Jefferson, was the father of Esten Hemmings, but we can say that someone with a Jeffersonian Y chromosome was the father of Esten Hemmings. So there's a limit to how much real identification you can do with Ys. It's really powerful for saying it's definitely not him. So like, for example, Sally Hemmings had another son, Thomas Woodson, and he had a different Y chromosome. So we can conclusively say that was not, he was not fathered by a Jeffersonian chromosome. Now, on the other side of the coin is the mitochondrial DNA, and it's kind of like the Y in that the mitochondria is only passed from mother to daughter. And so all of the women in here got your mitochondria from your mother, and you'll pass it on to any daughters that you have. Now, men also have mitochondria. So, you know, the mitochondria are very important for functioning. We all have mitochondria, but when it comes to passing it on to the next generation, only the females will pass their mitochondria onto the next generation. So again, it could be quite useful in these human identity if you could find relatives that belong in this family tree, you could use as comparison. Now we look at the sequence because the mitochondrial genome is so small. We simply look at the sequence of the DNA and we do a comparison. What is the differences between the sequence that you're looking at and a reference sequence? So we would say this particular person at position 263, the reference sequence has an A, this person has a G. So that's the way we would report mitochondrial DNA. And I'll take just a second to say that this work really, a lot of the work, the analysis work can go quite quickly. A lot of the work depends upon the type of sample that you're looking at. So as Peter mentioned, these bones that have been buried for 100 years in the frozen, you know, the ground in Ekaterinburg is frozen for about 8 months of the year. So you go through a little bit of freeze-thaw over 100 years. The types of bacteria that are living in the soil, bone is a very nice source of calcium, so there are minerals there, so there's a lot of feeding that happens on the material. So you take the bone and you try to sand away any of the, you know, and if there are any anthropologists in the room, I apologize. Anthropologists love to pick up bones and, you know, handle them, lick them, look at them. And so you have to be careful that you make sure you're getting rid of any external contamination. And then you grind the bone up into a powder, and then you digest this into a buffer, and that will help to release the DNA there. And so you're hoping that you're getting the DNA that's actually from the bone and not from some outside contaminant. So as Peter mentioned, because of the work that Avdovin did, we have the excavation in the early 90s of the first grave that was discovered. And as Peter mentioned, there was some debate because the American anthropologists believed that Anastasia was missing. They both agreed that there was a boy missing, that Alexei was not there. But the other daughter that was missing, the American experts believed that it was Anastasia, and the Russians believed that it was Maria. And so based upon the work that the Russians did, the facial reconstruction, for this talk, we'll move forward and say yes, that it was Maria that was missing. So, go ahead. So I'll talk very briefly about what Peter Gill did in 1991. And so he published his paper in 1994 in Nature Genetics, and he used the STR testing that we're using today. At the time, they were only looking at a few, looking here at five STRs. Remember, today we're using 13. And we're getting ready to move in the U.S. to 20 starting in 2017. So we're getting ready to look at more information. But at the time, there were only five STRs that were tested. And what Peter Gill could show is he could determine there was some of these skeletons look like they're related. And there's some skeletons that are absolutely not related. So these were the four servants that had different profiles. Okay. And so based upon the DNA work that was performed in the early 1990s, this is what Peter Gill was able to determine using mitochondrial sequencing and STR testing, is that you had remains that were consistent with Alexandra, the Tsarina, and three of her daughters, and they used as a reference someone in that maternal lineage, His Royal Highness Prince Philip, as a reference. He is a it was a cousin of the Tsarina, and so, or I should say Empress, and so they asked him for a sample of his blood, and he donated it, and they looked at the mitochondrial sequence, and it matched. Now, for the Tsar, it was a little bit different, because when you looked at his reference, the Tsar had what we call heteroplasmy, and that is that some of his mitochondrial DNA at this one position, 16169, had the T base, which I have in red, and some of his mitochondria had the C base. And so when you put those two together, one more time, you get in the sequence what looks like a mixture. A little bit of T, and underneath a C peak here. So at this one position, it looks like a mixture of two people, but you didn't see this anywhere else, only at this one position. And so when Pavel Ivanov came to the U.S., he's the Russian scientist who was involved with this first round of testing, and he met the director of AFDIL at the time, and Dr. Victor Whedon, and he said, you know, there's a lot of people that are having doubts about this heteroplasmy, because at the time, scientists didn't really know a whole lot about heteroplasmy. So he said, can I come to AFDIL and we do some more testing? So he did, And what he did was they exhumed Georgi, the Tsar's brother, who died of tuberculosis, and they exhumed his remains. And when you looked at the mitochondrial DNA of the Tsar and Georgi, you see the same heteroplasmy in the same position, but in different ratios. So this is where the Armed Forces DNA Lab first became involved, and we were able to show that this was not such a rare event, that it did happen, especially in this lineage. Okay. Now, despite the overwhelming evidence, there were a lot of concerns by people who were trying to discount the DNA testing. They were saying, well, you know, this heteroplasmy, we're not really sure what that's about. At the time, the mitochondrial DNA databases were quite small, just a few hundred people. So the statistics were not that overwhelming, but they were still substantial. And STRs were in their infancy. So fast forward now, 2007, as Peter mentioned, the news came out that we think we found the two missing children. And that's a picture that I took of Peter with the men standing beside of Peter were involved with the actual discovery. And this is a local archaeologist who did the dig, who actually did the excavation. As Peter mentioned, this is pretty much what we had. These were the largest bones there. There were 44 bones or bone fragments, and I think there were of those 40. I think there were three teeth there. Now, if you think about it, you have over 200 bones in your body. And there are two people here. So out of over 400 bones, you have less than 40 bones, fragments that were still there. So much of that material is gone, has been burned, or has disintegrated over time. So there were only a few bones that were really sufficient for DNA testing. And so that was the question. Are these the remains of the two missing children? So we have the sequence, the mitochondrial sequence from Peter Gill, okay? Go ahead. This is a bone from a leg, it's from a fragment of the leg. One thing I will mention about this is that these are only portion of a leg bone. So the anthropologists didn't have the luxury of doing these measurements to determine the height. And maybe then they could definitively prove or at least suggest that this was, you know, Anastasia or Maria. So the anthropology was quite limited in the remains that were recovered. Here's another fragment from a right femur, from a right leg bone, a thigh bone that was tested. And the sequence we got was the same that Peter Gill generated back in the 1990s. And I remember when this happened, we had Alexis Zakharin was our translator. He stayed with us the entire time because the two Russian scientists spoke no English, very little English. And he was there with us, and when this sequence came up on the computer, everyone started crying. I mean, even though we had all of this, we had all of this proof. I mean, we had all of this information that it was them, that it was the two missing children. But once we saw this sequence, everyone just broke down and was crying because it really meant a lot that we finally found the two missing children. So of all the fragments that we tested that we could get DNA from, again, we tested 10 pieces of 10 bones. The bones that we could get DNA from, they all had the same sequence, all right? But that doesn't tell you whether that was from Alexei or Maria. It just tells you that, you know, of the bones that were recovered, we had pretty good idea that one was from a female, one was from a male, based upon the anthropology. This time, we didn't have a database of 200 or 300. We had a database of 21,000. We've never seen this sequence before. So it's a unique sequence, again, which means that it's pretty rare. Okay. We also did STR testing, and so we took the fragment from what's believed to be a male And we see the two peaks, X and Y, which means that's from a male. And we see the one X peak here from a female. And the one thing that you notice when you look across this profile, I'm only showing you here three markers, the sex marker and then two other STR markers. When you look at the DNA profiles, you notice that, go ahead, there's a lot of sharing going along. The one peak here, the brother has, the sister has, or the putative sister has also that peak. So that suggests that these two individuals may be brother and sister. So we did this statistical test. We generated the profile of the female and the male. And we did this statistical test that's done for paternity testing and kinship testing. And we simply asked two questions. This is called a likelihood ratio. We simply asked two questions. Calculate the statistics as if these two individuals here are in fact brother and sister. And then calculate the statistics as if these two people were two people I grab at random in the population that are not related. So we have two different statistics that we calculate, and then we take the ratio, which one makes most sense, which one explains the data better. Is it more information that they are related or that they're not related? And when you did this test, you found that it was 5.6 million times more likely that the remains are brother and sister than if the remains were two people we picked out of the population. So very strong evidence that these are related individuals, brother and sister. As Peter mentioned, because of the previous testing that was done, the lab in Ekaterinburg kept some of that material, that DNA material from the Tsar, the Tsarina, and the three daughters. So we're able to get STR testing on all of the family. And when you do that, you notice here on top is the Tsar, here on the bottom is the Tsarina, and in the middle here we have Alexei. And when you look at the peaks, go ahead, you can see that every peak in this child can be explained if the Tsar and the Tsarina were the mother and father. So as you would expect, a child gets half his DNA from the mother and half from the father. And we'll do this again for the female, for the skeletal sample. We get at every peak, we can explain her profile from the Tsar and the Tsarina. So we developed profiles for everyone. And when we did that likelihood ratio test, when we asked the question, these two individuals, the boy and the girl, do they belong into this family tree with the Tsar, the Tsarina, and the three sisters? Well, for the girl, her probability was 4.3 trillion, and for Alexei, it was 80 trillion. So the results are 4.6 trillion to 80 trillion times more likely if these two individuals are in this family tree than if there were just two people at random in the population that would fit into this pedigree. So since we did have Alexei and we did have the Tsar, we decided to do Y chromosome testing back in the early 90s. There was no YSTR testing at that time. So when you look at the profile from the Tsar, which is on top, or I'm sorry, from Alexei and from the Tsar, they match at all. We look at 17 markers. They all matched exactly at all 17. And then as a relative, we used Andrew Romanov from California. He's a cousin of both Nicholas and Alexei. And when you look at his profile, he matches it all 17. So we had a perfect match between a living relative and the remains from Nicholas and Alexei. As far as the rarity, how often do you see this? Well, in 20,000, a database of 20,000 YSTR types, we haven't seen this haplotype before. So it's quite rare. So I'll take just a second and talk about the work that the ladies in Ekaterinburg, these are the ladies that work at the DNA lab in Ekaterinburg. Again, two of these ladies came to, actually on the right and the left, came to the U.S., and two of the scientists went to Austria. Now, they did DNA testing, along with Dr. Rogayev, on this shirt, bloody shirt, that Nicholas wore. So when Nicholas was a young man, his father sent him on a world tour, and during a stop in Japan, he was attacked by someone who was mentally disturbed, who I think was dressed as a policeman, but he had a saber. He came and he hit Nicholas on the side of his head and, you know, created this huge gash. And so Nicholas was bleeding all over his shirt. In fact, Nicholas's cousin was able to stop the attack. He had just bought a bamboo stick as a souvenir just minutes before. And when he looked around and saw Nicholas being attacked, he hit the guy with the stick and was able to disable him so that they stopped this guy from killing him. And so the wounds were present there, as far as the anthropology goes. But I won't mention, I'm not an anthropologist, so I won't talk too much about that. But the shirt that Nicholas was wearing was sent back to Moscow for after the attack, and was as proof of what had happened. And so eventually the shirt made its way to the Hermitage Museum. And here in the 2009, 2010, we're doing DNA testing, and Mr. Soloviev says, "Hey, you know," he calls up the Hermitage and he says, "You guys have this shirt with blood from Nicholas. You think we could do some testing on that?" And they said, "No, we can't find this shirt. We have no idea where it is." You know, they didn't have a lot of good record keeping and so forth. They knew at some point in the 1930s that it was in some museum of the Revolution or something, and then it was sent. And so no one had really any idea where it was. Well, at about the same time, there was a lot of pilfering of artifacts that was going on at the Hermitage. So they decided, and thanks to donations from friends of the Hermitage Museum and so forth, they were able to get them a computer system where they could document everything. And so they're going through and they open up this drawer and they see something wrapped in this brown paper. They open it up and they found the shirt and the hat, the derby hat that he was wearing. So the Russians were quite excited. "Well, you know, can we do DNA testing? Well, what do you plan to do?" "Well, we're going to, you know, we'll cut out a little bit of the, you know..." "No, there'll be no cutting." So they said it was okay to take like a Q-tip and some water and sort of rub the blood, and, you know, there you go. That's what you can do. So that's what they did. And just to show the beauty of this shirt, the craftsmanship. So the tag 1931 is the tag that was on it. Go ahead. And so you can see they took a sample up here from the collar that had a little bit of crust on it, where the blood had sort of crusted over time. And so, again, you can see where they took a little bit of a Q-tip and a swab and sort of swabbed this area where the blood was dripping down onto the shirt. They also swabbed this area of the sleeve where Nicholas was holding the side of his head. So the profile that the Russian scientists got was the exact same profile that we got from the bones. And they also did YSTR testing, and they got the same answer as we did for the Ys. So interestingly, you have a DNA profile from Nicholas when he was living, from the blood on the shirt, and we have the DNA profile from his bones after he died, and they matched. Do you have a question?
Yeah, did he die when he ate his head?
No, he didn't die. He survived the attack, and he went back home. But he survived that attack. Okay. And one. So we had complete concordance with... So a lot of times, DNA tends to get all of the glory, all of the honor, because it's used a lot in fighting crime. But I'd like to point out in this case that DNA is actually just one piece of the puzzle. when you take a look at all the other artifacts, like the bullets that were recovered, and within those 44 bone fragments that Peter has talked about, there's a piece of pottery, which they know was used, the sulfuric acid was purchased and used to try to disintegrate the remains. So we found pieces of pottery with Japanese writing on it. So there's a lot of information there. So if we take a look at the forensic DNA evidence, you have evidence from the mitochondrial DNA, which agrees. You have evidence from the forensic STRs, which agrees that these are, in fact, members of this family. And you also have the Y chromosome evidence. So taken together, it's very strong evidence here from the DNA that we have the two missing children. Peter wanted me to mention about the work that Rogaev did on hemophilia. So we know that hemophilia runs through the royal families of Europe because of Queen Victoria. And with Alexandra being a granddaughter of Queen Victoria, we know that Alexei had hemophilia. And so Rogaev was actually able to find, a lot of people think that that the hemophilia was a deficiency in factor 8. We'll show that it's, that was not the case. But before we do that, one more quick review. The way that you make a protein in your body, so if it's a protein like insulin or something like that, you start with a DNA that you have, and that gets transcribed into a message, and we call it messenger RNA. And that messenger RNA then gets made into a protein. So you have DNA makes messenger RNA makes a protein. Got a little soundtrack going on. So so this is the way the DNA is organized. It seems a little crazy, but that's just the way it is. When you look at your DNA and you want to make a protein, like one of these proteins that are used for clotting blood, the way the DNA is organized is you have these sequences called exons, which are in blue. That's what's actually transcribed into the messenger RNA. And then you'll have these red regions, which are called introns, which are just junk DNA. It doesn't code for anything. It's just a bunch of gibberish. So it's kind of like reading a book, and you're reading like 5 or 6 pages, and then you've got like 10 pages of gibberish. And you're like, so you have to skip up, and then you pick back up and you start reading again. So this is the way that our DNA is organized. And they think that it's probably because if your DNA was just simply pure, this is the code for how to make this protein. And if a mutation happens, well, then you're pretty much in trouble because there's no way to correct that. So if a mutation happens in an intron, no big deal. We can still get the information from the exon. So what happens is when you go to make this message, the red parts are cut out and the blue parts are put together to make this one message that then gets made into a protein. So the way that happens is you have enzymes that are reading the DNA and they know exactly where to cut. We're going to chop here, and we're going to cut out this intron. Okay, so if you take a look at blood clotting disorders, when you cut yourself, there's a lot of things happening. There's this cascade of enzymes will cut this this protein, and then that activates this, and then that, and so you eventually, with all these little factors that are getting these factors that are being created to create the clot. It requires a lot of enzymes and proteins to do so. So one way that you can get hemophilia is if you are missing or if you have some issue with factor 8, which is one of the proteins in this process. The other way is if you have a deficiency in factor 9. So if you knock out either one of these, then the pathway to making a clot is broken. And so you have issues. When you cut yourself, you can't stop the bleeding, or not very efficiently. So what they found was that when you look at here in this red, the red here represents all of the exons that are necessary for making factor 9, which is, again, one of these protein products. And what Rogaev found was that there was a mutation at this point here in the fourth exon for making factor 9. So basically what happened is, instead of having the normal AAG, which is what the enzyme recognizes, AAG, cut here, okay? Instead of it being an AAG, Alexei had an AGA. So the mutation occurred, and that the consequence of that is that the enzyme could not cut that exon from the intron. So in the next slide, what you get basically is this. No cutting, you produce a protein that has this. Both the exon and intron, and then the rest is good. But because you have all of this gibberish junk, when it comes time to make that protein, you don't make a proper protein. It makes a non-functional protein, so you can't clot. So that was the problem that Alexei had. So Rogaev was able to discover this, and he found that not only was it present in the Tsarina, she was a carrier. So usually females are protected because they have two X chromosomes. So if one copy of the gene is bad, then females have a backup copy, have another X. But for males, it's usually afflicted because you only have one X chromosome. You don't have another X. You have a Y. So that's why mostly males are afflicted by these blood clotting diseases. So Alexei had only one X. Anastasia, had she lived, would have been a carrier for this hemophilia. She would have passed this gene. If she had had sons, they would have been afflicted. There's a 50-50 chance she would have passed it to any of her female children. And I'll finish up with, of course, there's always this mythology about the missing Romanov children, how somehow they miraculously survived that night. And the most famous, at least, I think, was Anna Anderson, who believed that she was Anastasia and convinced a lot of people that she was Anastasia. When she died of colon cancer. She wanted her body cremated. And so this was before DNA testing, so that wasn't such a big thing. But so once the DNA testing had happened, you know, we were in the early 90s with the discovery of the missing family, the researchers were actually able to disprove that she was, in fact, Romanov, because the biopsy that she had taken at the University of Virginia Hospital for colon cancer, they kept that biopsy material. And so they were able to go back and do DNA testing. And it's kind of hard to see here, but the STR testing here is, let me see if you can pass my test, all right? So here's I'll give you a certificate for being a junior forensic scientist if you can answer this question. Is it possible for a father who's an 1132 and a mother who's a 3236 have a child that's a 1518? No. Okay, end of story. There's no way Anna Anderson could have been Anastasia because she does not have the same DNA type that you would expect to be from a daughter of the Tsar and the Tsarina. So since 1918, there have been a lot of people who have claimed to be one of the missing children. There have been 81 men who claim to be Alexei. Peter's friend Nikitin once told me when we were in Russia, he said, yeah, you know, it's the funniest thing. There were 5 children went down into that basement and 200 came out. So I think we can, at least with the DNA testing, we can now conclude that all of the children were executed that night, that early morning. So if you want more information, we published our results in this journal called PLOS1, PLOS1. And if you do a Google search of Romanov and PLOS One or whatever, it's a free article. You don't have to subscribe to the journal. You don't have to pay for it. We decided to make it openly available for anyone to download and read. And so you can go to the journal website and you can download this freely if you are interested. There are a lot of people I'd like to thank, and several in this room, for all of the work and for allowing me to be a part of this history, as Father Richter said. So I'll end my part here, and maybe we won't take questions at the moment, but we'll set up Peter to finish off his current work.
Thank you, Michael. Right now, we told the world about the results of this DNA studies on December 5th, 2008. That very same day, Patriarch Alexis II passed away. So he had a representative at our talk in Ekaterinburg, our presentation, but it went nowhere with the new patriarch, who did not want to hear about the case. So, I felt that our work here was totally completed. While working with in the first searches with Vladimir Konstantinov, the radar guy expert, he told me about that he had friends in Perm who had an idea where the remains of Mikhail Romanov might be. So the following year I called him up. I said, let's go search for Mikhail Romanov. I mean, if they don't believe us our results of Nicholas II, let's just try to find Mikhail Romanov and try to prove them wrong, or try to add to the case. Unfortunately, as you know, a lot of work went towards the Romanovs, towards Nicholas, the identification of Nicholas II. It was not only DNA, but as far as the bullets, I found the first bullet in the first grave. Then in the main grave where the bridge was, they found a lot of bullets. And then when the last two children were found in 2007, we found more bullets that were actually there. And it turns out that the killers left their guns in the museum because they wanted to be remembered. So the ballistics tests were done, and they found that the same bullets fired from the same gun were in all three spots. So that's another little proof. So I went in 2009, Konstantinov and I went to Perm to search for the remains of Mikhail Romanov and his secretary, Brian Johnson, whose father was a sea captain, a British sea captain as well. Next. We started out with prayer, and every search that we've done was with prayer. But you must remember one thing, that when Ardonin was searching for the remains of the royal family, he had the Yurovsky paper. Yurovsky, the killer, wrote in exact detail and left it with his family and in the archives as to where the remains were, the bridge. We don't have any that luxury. We have what the killers wrote. But it's all, it's very inconsistent. And so when we first arrived in Perm, we found that there were 9 different versions of where Mikhail might be. And so we started studying all the cases, and we felt that the place where we first started looking, was vast, but was the most interesting case for us. Next. This is Konstantinov with the radar. First, we were taken, by the way, to not to the area we're searching now, but to a different area. And looking up, we saw the letter M and the letter A on a tree. And I got excited. I said, because the killers wrote also that they carved the letter M and the letter A and VK, also Veliki Knyaz, on a tree. We didn't see a VK. But the problem was that the M and the A were way up on a tree. And I didn't know it then until I started working with NecroSearch International, and I got a forensic botanist who came and said, no. Tree, if you put your initials on a tree at eye level, it will remain that way, because trees do not grow that way. Trees do not, the markings will not go up. They'll stay level, and the trees will go out, and they go up from the top. So no way, this is a fake. So, okay, now we're down to 8 versions, you know, so nice. So, Konstantinov in the middle with his radar, Dr. Sergei Nikitin, and then Igor is also another radar expert, came with us in 2012. 2009, we worked there for 3 days. We didn't know anyone. We got rained out, and we said, let's go home. 2012, we went back, and we started searching. This one area where the Michael Grand Duke Michael and Brian Johnson were taken from the hotel where they were staying and taken north to the town of Motovilichi, which is north of Perm, big factory, and then they were driven about 6 kilometers north on the Solikamsky tract. They turned off the track and went about maybe 200 to 400 yards, and were killed. This was around midnight, it was raining. The killers covered the bodies with brush, went back. The next morning, two of them came back and buried them. Where they buried them, no one knows. So we started looking. The most, from my, our investigations and police investigation, killers will bury people in areas that they are familiar with. To bury a person of a large size, let's say if there's a road, they will go maybe about 20 meters off the road max. If it's child, they'll go 100 meters. But here, they even wrote they went about 20 meters off the road. So we were close, so keep going. So Konstantinov, every time the radar saw something, he would bring up samples, which is, that's his way of doing things. That's the only person I had. Next. But we started looking at trying to find caves and try to find also not only caves but mine shafts in the area. So we had to went to museums, we went to the archives looking for maps of the whole area. And this area became the most interesting for us, because this is about the distance that they traveled north of Motovilichi. They turned right. One of the killers owned land on the other side of the hill here. So he was very familiar. This area is surrounded by, on the other side of this field, on the back, it's called Krasnogorka Red Hill. It's very steep, and there's valleys inside, a hidden area. And this is where the Bolsheviks had their Mayovsky, their meetings in 1905, hiding, which they used to hide from the police. Next. And the church, this is already 2014, 2015. So let me just go on with tell you that with Konstantinov, we searched out part of the area, and we were going to go back the next year. Unfortunately, he passed away. So in my travels, and I got to know through my American scientist, Diane France from Colorado State University, who I took in February to examine the remains. Diane France is part of a group called NecroSearch International. It's a group of about 30 different scientists from 16 different sciences that have come together to search for remains and search for and work with the FBI, the police, and myself. This is the spot that Konstantina felt was the most logical spot where we would find Mikhail. As you can see, I'm looking down from a hill, the hill of the other side. This is where and this used to be old fields. This is young forest. On the other side here, the swampy area. But they started searching, and then you know, it's like we have the forest, and you have to knock down the forest. We didn't have the means to do that. We didn't have, you know, and then we brought on, not only from NACO Search International, I'm working with Clark Davenport, forensic geophysicist, also working with, I take a cadaver dog from the UK. I have a forensic archaeologist working, and these fellas have worked finding remains from wars and so forth, and know the methods for searching for remains, which we applied over here. So continue, please. So this is Mick with a search dog, Sam. Unfortunately, Sam passed away. Now we have Ronnie. And what Mick does he has a metal rod, and he pokes holes every 30 centimeters from the ground, which brings up any gases that might be trapped even over time. Sam has found remains that were about 35 years in the sand in Ireland. And Ronnie is a young dog now, but he's well trained. He also can find cancer, skin cancer. Next. So we started chopping down the forest, very slow method. And then decided to dig down. See, we're looking for the road that they traveled. And we felt, by looking at the old maps, we followed the contour of the map, and we felt that, all right, so we find the road, determine where the road is, and then we'll search 20 meters on one side, 30 meters on one side, 30 meters on the other, and like that. But what did we find? We found cobblestones. A cobblestone road that was about 300, it turned out it was about 300 meters long, 900 feet, about 10 meters wide, 30 feet wide. It was built by the German war prisoners from 1942 to 1947 or so. And there was no forest there. I guess that was abandoned. And this led to a brick factory at the end of the road, and the brick factory has been there for a long time. Keep going. So instead, I got one of these to clear the forest out. Of course, we have permits and so forth. And we also found signs where the old trees were. We took GPS readings of where those old trees were, because when we're through with everything, we're going to put those trees back where the new trees back where the old ones used to be, and bring the forest back where what it was in 1918. Next. All right, we did this in one search, one season. But now we just can't carpet, cut down the whole forest. So what we're doing now, I'm going back to Russia next week, in 2 weeks actually, and I'm hiring a geophysical company that's going to do radar studies. They're doing in the snow. The snow is like maybe half a meter or so. And on skis, they do it. They go around trees and all this. So what we'll get is, and they're connected to GPS. So as they're reading it, we'll get the GPS signal. And we'll get readings for the whole forest all the way down to the next road, which is almost a kilometer. And my guys in Colorado, NecroSearch, will then get the information and do a 3D map underground. So from that, we'll get to see what's underground, what's underneath those trees without even cutting down a tree. Next. We went down to the level of 1918, but in a different spot. That area had been disturbed before. There were prisoner camps there. There were different things that occurred. We haven't found any remains at all. The stream that was there moved, so I also have to move the stream back to where it was. So this is getting very, very complicated. Next. We also have the fellas that found Alexis and Maria come and help us. We found bullets from, it is a 55 caliber, I think that's what it is. They were practice shooting at that guy, from that guy's land, so we know exactly, have an idea where that guy lived. Right next to his place was a swamp. So we want to search that swamp out. That is our goal, too. Next. And we had that's Ronnie. Okay, next. The radar, Dima is from southern Russia, and an archaeologist who comes and work with us. So we have Russian, British, and American scientists working together in this politically charged world. And frankly, we don't care about politics, we care about history. And we're trying to solve a historical issue. Go ahead, next. Clark Davenport, geophysical. This machine here, it reads the amount of let us know how much water, let's say the ground is holding, or how much, you know, and he can see if it's hard or if it's not, the ground is hard. Nice. So this is the area that we searched. That's the cobblestone road. Nice. So from the top looking down, there's a jail over here, there's a jail over here. Next. This is our American team. And this is our Russian team. Just to enclose, we were having fun. But we do have fun at the same time. But just in closing, right now, there's a commission that was formed in Perm by order of the government to study everything that is available on Mikhail Romanov in that whole area. They're studying the archives, especially hopefully the presidential archive as well, for any information regarding the Romanovs, especially Mikhail Romanov and Brian Johnson. And so stay tuned. We're going back again next summer for 3 weeks. Thank you very much.
Any questions?
Who finances this project?
The people that finance my project are Russians living in the United States, and also the Russian Nobility Association in America. We also have donors in Russia who help with transportation. The church supplies us food, hot lunches, the monastery. So we eat monastery food every day in the field, even the heat and everything. But it's good to get hot soup even when it's hot. I have a foundation, nonprofit foundation, and I get people that donate money to the foundation, and that's how I make it work. This year I have, you know, I'm always looking for people that, if they're willing to donate to help out, please do. Thank you very much.
One more question.
On the 23rd of September last year, according to Vladimir Tikhon-Shapunov, a commission was created to investigate, to authenticate the remains. And it's supposed to produce results at the end of January or the beginning of February, which is about now. And the commission includes academician Alexeyev, Vladika Tikhon, and also chairman from the Moskovsky Patriarchate, Vladimir Degoida. And Vladika Tikhon invited all people who investigated the remains to submit their results to the commission also. So the question is, first, did you have a chance to submit your results to the commission? And the second question is, it seems like there is no stone unturned at this point, and your conclusions are so conclusive, and yet why the why do they do another investigation?
Good question. I think the church has the right to make sure that no question is unanswered, that every question is answered. I mean, first of all, when they opened up now, they redid the DNA that we did in 2018. They redid the DNA of the Tsar. They did the DNA of the children. They did the DNA of the shirt that was done in Ekaterinburgen by Dr. Rogaev. They did the DNA, they exhumed Alexander III. They did his DNA. And guess what? Everything is matched for the 2008 results. Right, that is no question. Okay, still now, very important, they formed commission to examine all the archives, to get all the information that they can. To this day, they haven't done all the work that's needed to be done. They want to have, the church wants to have all their questions answered. At first, there was a question as whether I've done and found three skulls, but where are the three skulls taken in 1918 to Moscow? And why did Yurovsky, when Sokolov entered the Ipatiev house, he also found receipts for three hat boxes that Yurovsky had ordered. Why would Yurovsky order three hat boxes if not to carry threads to Moscow, and as proof of the murder. And I tell you this: I know what I did in February of 1998. I took two forensic anthropologists, and we were allowed to examine the remains. And one of the things that I did was to ask them to check the neck bones of Nicholas II to see if his head had been cut off, and they said there's absolutely nothing here to indicate that had occurred. And when they examined the other remains, same thing. And now when they opened up the grave again of Nicholas II, I'm sure they checked that, and saw something written that there was no indication also that had been done. So that was one of the questions. As far as other questions that remain unanswered, I believe that all the questions that the church had been answered. But the archives still have to be searched. There's a lot of people working on this case. There's a lot of people that have the ear of the patriarch also, who are against anything, against these remains. And I frankly, if they really read the information, they will see that clearly we'll see that these are the remains of the royal family. Absolutely no doubt that it's them. I was supposed to be in that commission as well. And because in my bio I wrote, there's no doubt that these are the Romanovs. Probably that's why they never called me.
If I can just interject my personal opinion on why the church doesn't recognize has doubts and wants this commission, frankly, I think it's they're embarrassed, and this is face-saving, because they denied the authenticity the first time around, and now they're delaying, and then when finally they can't deny it anymore, they'll say, well, at least we did all this extra work to make sure. In all my reading of church history, I've never encountered any set of relics which have been investigated, reinvestigated as much and as scientifically as these. When Saint Seraphim of Sarov was found in the anti-religious museum in Kazan, in the attic, nobody had doubts that these were his relics. Although they weren't labeled, they were in some box, and they were recognized as his relics. But for some reason, the royal family—it's crazy. I mean, how many times can you test. You all saw what Dr. Noble, Dr. Coble, showed us. I mean, it's well, a very noble task, Dr.
Very noble, Dr.
Coble. Yes, very noble, Dr. Coble. I mean, it's amazing the trillions, you know, and yet there are still people who are denying it. I think they're just embarrassed, frankly.
I believe that there will be an end, and I think sometimes I think that perhaps they're waiting till 2018, but they gave themselves at first. When they said, "Oh, we'll have the burial in October," I said, "There's not enough time for them to study all the material. They have to push it back." And finally, they realized they pushed it back to as long as necessary to get all the information to become convinced. And as one said, I think several chaplains said, "Well, we convinced all the people that it was not them. Now, you know, if we start trying, so all of a sudden we say that it is them, I won't be able to walk through the streets of Ekaterinburg." So I think that you have to give it time. And the church needs time. They have all the time. And then that's fine. Meantime, I look for Mikhail Romanov. And once I find Mikhail Romanov, it'll be extra proof for that. Thank you very much.
The question was, are you going to submit your findings to this new commission?
Oh, no. I gave all our findings, all our reports, we gave to the church in 2009. They have all that information. I gave them a binding, so.
But they want it again.
I wasn't asked for it. I don't think I will be. But we could just show it to them, but they already know what our results are. And frankly, they can do the DNA testing as many times as they want, and the truth will persevere. The truth is that these are the remains of the royal family and their children. Thank you very much.
Maybe if we have time for one more question, we have a service in
a couple of hours.
Right, so, anyway, any other questions? Anyway, these talks will be on YouTube, so you're welcome to visit our YouTube channel and tell your friends. And so the ones who couldn't make it today can watch and learn a lot. Thank you. Thank you all.